Good morning, everyone. It is so wonderful to be here. I know some of you personally, and I recognize lots of familiar faces. Every time I have an opportunity to come to this congregation, it brings me pure joy inside and out. I spend so much of my time in congregations of all faiths across the state, and it really means the world to me to be able to come home to my family in the UU Church. So thank you for being here, and I really appreciate Reverend Tom for this opportunity. So if you've heard me speak before, you most often hear me talk about the issues and impacts of climate change as a global imperative. And if you thought that's what I was going to talk about today, we're in a different phase of my thinking in what needs to happen at a spiritual level in order to move into addressing climate justice at the levels that we really need to. And so I've been doing some interior journey work of how I relate to the UU Seven Principles, and I appreciate this opportunity again to go on this journey together this morning. Breathing life into UU Seven Principles. How many times in your life have you been asked, what do Unitarian Universalists believe? Is that same question something that we ask each other? Do we ask it to ourselves? Often the most common response to the question of what do UUs believe in is deeds, not creeds. It seems this haiku-like answer consistently comes from a place of resistance to an authoritative formula of religious beliefs, theologies that we venomously reject as people who either identify as lifelong Unitarian Universalists or as individuals and families being called to the UU faith as a place to experience freedom from the bonds of religious fundamentalism. To say Unitarian Universalists believe in deeds, not creeds, suggests that members of UU congregations have a collective understanding that what we do and how we live is the true expression of our beliefs, rather than relying on a hierarchical theology to explain our nature and purpose of existence. Our reading this morning came from the UUA's beliefs website titled Who We Are. To reference what we are is to define what we are being. And this requires us all to know the past, to know the present. For this reason, it's worth spending our time together this morning to reflect upon where UUs have been with regards to principal statements over the course of the last 60 years, in order to better help us understand what's happening in our world right now, what our collective conscience is debating, and what dialogues are being created. In the year 2000, an article titled, How the UUA's Principles and Purposes Were Shaped and How They Shaped Unitarian Universalism, was published in UU World Magazine to mark the 15th anniversary of the adoption of the Unitarian Universalist Association's current statement of principles and purposes. Written by longtime contributing editor Warren R. Ross, it begins by stating, and I quote, "There are few issues concerning Unitarian Universalism of which UUs can agree with one another. Are we a denomination? That is, a single religious entity? Or merely an association of independent congregations? Is the congregation's independence, what we call congregational polity, a sacrosanct principle, or must it yield to our commitment to racial justice? Do we call the places where we gather for worship churches or meeting halls? Indeed, do we worship?" Those are all perennial subjects for debate. But few questions cause us as much discomfort as what to say when asked what UUs believe. After all, we don't all believe the same thing. But even as we vehemently reject any creed, we seem to be forever searching for some verbal formulation about which all, or at least most, of us can say, yes, that's what I, more or less, believe. End quote. The importance of our being able to express a set of shared core beliefs was well described by the Reverend Eugene Pickett. When he assumed the UUA presidency in 1979, he proclaimed, and I quote, "The deeper malaise lies in our confusion as to what word we have to spread. The old watchwords of liberalism, freedom, reason, tolerance, worthy though they may be, are simply not catching the imagination of the contemporary world. They describe a process for approaching the religious depths, but they testify to no intimate acquaintance with the depths themselves. If we are ever to speak to a new age, we must supplement our seeking with some profound religious finds." End quote. The original statement of the six purposes of the Unitarian Universalist Association, adopted in 1960, as the Universalist Church of America and the American Unitarian Association were consolidated, they no longer served the need. Just 5 years into Reverend Pickett's UUA presidency, new UU principles and purposes that replaced the original wording were adopted nearly unanimously and have lasted virtually unchanged for 45 years. The principles and purposes are featured in the front of our handbook. In fact, according to the hymn book's introduction, the commission that assembled the book took them as, quote, "the touchstones of our decision to proclaim our diversity," end quote. The UU seven principles have been woven into the fabric of our denominational life. This morning, I am highlighting an additional set of touchstones being embraced across our country's democratic movement building initiatives. And if you are already familiar, or if this is your first time that you are hearing of them, I imagine you will harmoniously resonate with these guiding values and practices. In December 1996, 12 years after the UU seven principles were written, 40 people of color and European American representatives met in Jemez, New Mexico for the working group meeting on globalization and trade. The Jemez meeting was hosted by the Southeast Network for Environmental and Economic Justice, Southwest Network for Environmental and Economic Justice, with the intention of hammering out common understandings between participants from different cultures, politics, and organizations. The following Jemez principles for democratic organizing were adopted by the participants and have become the guiding values for the climate justice movement. And I will say, North Carolina Interfaith Power and Light is a member of the U.S. Climate Action Network. And in order to be a part of that network, we have had to adopt these as our guiding principles. And as an organization, are held accountable to how we live into these principles. Each have a guiding principle title, along with descriptions of entailed actions. I'm going to share those with you. Number one, be inclusive. If we hope to achieve just societies that include all people in decision-making, and assure that all people have an equitable share of the wealth and the work of this world, then we must work to build that kind of inclusiveness into our own movement in order to develop alternative policies and institutions to the treaties, policies under neoliberalism. This requires more than tokenism. It cannot be achieved without diversity at the planning table, in staffing, and It may delay achievement of other important goals. It will require discussion, hard work, patience, and planning. It may involve conflict, but through this conflict, we can learn better ways of working together. It's about building alternative institutions, movement building, and not compromising out in order to be accepted into the anti-globalization club. Number two, emphasis up on bottom-up organizing. To succeed, it is important to reach out into new constituencies and to reach within all levels of leadership and membership base of the organizations that are already involved in our networks. We must continually be building and strengthening a base which provides our credibility, our strategies, mobilizations, leadership development, and the energy for the work we must do daily. Number three, let people speak for themselves. We must be sure that relevant voices of people directly affected are heard. Ways must be provided for spokespersons to represent and be responsible to the affected constituencies. It is important for organizations to clarify their roles and who they represent, and to assure accountability within our structures. Number four, work together in solidarity and mutuality. Groups working on similar issues with compatible visions should consciously act in solidarity, mutuality, and support each other's work. In the long run, a more significant step is to incorporate the goals and values of other groups with our own work in order to build strong relationships. For instance, in the long run, it is more important that labor unions and community economic development projects include the issues of environmental sustainability in their own strategies rather than just lending support to the environmental organization. So communications, strategies, and resources sharing is critical to help us see our connections and build on these. Number five, build just relationships among ourselves. We need to treat each other with justice and respect, both on an individual and an organizational level, in this country and across borders. Defining and developing just relationships will be a process that won't happen overnight. It must include clarity about decision-making, sharing strategies, and resource distribution. There are clearly many skills necessary to succeed, and we need to determine the ways for those with different skills to coordinate and be accountable to one another. And finally, number six, commitment to self-transformation. As we change societies, we must change from operating on the mode of individualism to community-centeredness. We must walk our walk. We must be the values that we say we're struggling for, and we must be justice, be peace, be community. These are the principles of democratic organizing adopted by the International Climate Justice Movement. And I believe living into the Hermes principles gives practical application to our UU7 principles. And so it is with perfect grace that just last year, the book Justice on Earth, People of Faith Working at the Intersections of Race, Class, and Environment, was published by Skinner Books and chosen as the UUA's 2018-2019 Common Read. Justice on Earth's anthology presents a powerful and penetrating look at environmental justice from some of the key thinkers and activists in Unitarian Universalism today. 14 activist ministers and lay leaders apply a keen intersectional analysis to the environmental crisis, revealing ways that capitalism, white supremacy, patriarchy, and other systems of oppression intersect with and contribute to ecological devastation. They also explore how spiritual practices, congregational organizing, and progressive theology can inform faith-based justice work in the 21st century. The UUA's Common Read Discussion Guide offers Unitarian Universalist congregations, groups, and individuals a single 90-minute session and a more in-depth three-session series, giving diverse people a shared experience, shared language, and a basis for deep, meaningful conversations. As UUs, it is important on a regular basis to remind ourselves of where we have come, where we are now, and where we need to go. By doing so, today will irreversibly become the past of the future. As we move forward together, not one step back, each considering our individual and collective roles, we will breathe new life into our social and spiritual practices that embody our shared values towards the vision of a beloved community with justice for all. Please join me in lifting up our Singing the Living Tradition hymnal books and turn to the page just before the first song. Let us together take a big breath as we read in unison and breathe ever-renewing life into our shared UU7 principles as a covenant to affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of every person, justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, acceptance of one another, and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations, a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, the right of conscience,
and the use of the democratic process within our congregations and in society at large, the goal of the world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part.
As we use, we are on the righteous path, and we have a